Good morning to all the teachers present here. Today is 5th September and a red letters day in the history of India as we commemorate the birth anniversary of our first Vice President, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, who was a scholar and teachers of repute. Teachers for ages have always played a vital role in molding and shaping the lives of a student by inspiring, motivating, and guiding them to be ideal citizens a country would be proud of. Even during the global pandemic of COVID-19, teachers across the country have relentlessly worked day and night and adopted the new methodology and changing dynamics of imparting knowledge. I would like to extend my gratitude to every teachers for their selfless service and dynamic support to nation building. Here is wishing all the teachers a happy Teachers Day. I am Dr. Rajkumar Arya, Associate Professor, Department of Chemical Engineering, NIT Jalandhar, and I take the privilege to welcome you all to the webinar on IT not only enabler but critical element of engineering and business operations, to be conducted by our expert, Mr. Praveen Barma, Global Program Director, Energy and Utilities, Birlasoft India. I now take the pleasure to introduce you to Professor Dr. Lalit Kumar Awasthi sir, who is the Honorable Director of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar National Institute of Technology, Jalandhar, and sir has taken out his valuable time from the tight schedule to be part of this webinar. We also have convener and HOD of the Chemical Engineering Department, Dr. Sangeeta Garg, my fellow coordinator, Dr. Anurag Tiwari, and all other faculty members, participants, students online for the webinar. So far, we have 500 participants attending the webinar, and more will join in few minutes. So before we proceed with the webinar, I request Madam Dr. Sangeeta Garg, Associate Professor and Head Chemical Engineering Department, to share her thoughts. Sangeeta ma'am, please.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Arya. So, first, I wish all of you a very happy Teachers' Day. Yeah, it's our privilege that our webinar is on this very auspicious occasion of the Teachers' Day. So, now I will start with the proceedings. So, our Honorable Director, sir, Professor L.K. Awasthi. Today's speaker, Mr. Praveen Barma, Global Program Director, Energy and Utilities, Biosoft Limited, Birlasoft Limited, Dr. Rajkumar Arya, and Dr. Anurag Tiwari, coordinators of the webinar. My dear participants, faculty members, I welcome you all to the today's session on IT not only enabler, but critical element of engineering and business operations. Thanks, Dr. Arya, for bringing such a relevant topic. Although IT is not end, but means to achieve that end, I think so. For ages, we had been considering IT as an enabler, which is true, by the way, but today IT has taken the bigger place in not only the critical engineering applications, but our day-to-day life also. Today, the world is talking of Industry 4.0. Yes, we chemical engineers need to think beyond our core and embrace IT as the part and parcel of our tough engineering designs and problems. So with this, I wish this webinar a great success. So now I invite our director, sir, to say a few words.
Good morning.
Morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
On this auspicious occasion of Teachers' Day, I congratulate all the teachers. I bow to all my teachers, due to whom I am here as director of this institute. I wish every teacher a happy Teachers' Day. Teachers are known as nation builders, and we need to keep that dignity intact. And all the faculty members at NIT Jalandhar, they have been contributing to their fullest potential, and I can see the way the institute is shaping since last 4 years. It's my privilege, and I congratulate all faculty members for their contributions and bringing up the institution by 61 institutions to stand at tally of 52 in the national ranking framework, ranking of MHRD. Similarly, the NIT Jalandhar has been put with many IITs on innovation, utter innovation ranking, and we stand there at as a A grade institutions between 11 to 25 in whole country. So these are the accomplishments of the faculty here. The students have also brought big laurel to the institute, and I definitely congratulate them, their parents, and hope that the institute as well as the country, our beloved country India, will be shaping into a very good and country which will be having a recognition worldwide. So coming to this today's topic, we have Mr. Parveen Kumar, Global Program Director, Energy and Utilities, Birla Soft India. So before I come to this topic, a couple of minutes, I introduce this institute. NIT Jalandhar came as Regional Engineering College Jalandhar in 1987, and then it was rechristened as National Institute of Importance under MHRD in 2007 by Act of Parliament. The institute offers 11 undergraduate programs with the intake of 1135 and 16 M.Tech programs, roughly an intake of 550. We also offer MBA. We offer PhD program in all disciplines of engineering, science and management. So for all practical purposes, we are a university of national importance, NIT. The topic is very relevant, and we have the learned speaker, Mr. Parveen Verma, who will be enlightening you for IT, not only enabler but critical element. I, being from computer science field, so I strongly is with this statement. And as you see, everything when I get up, and most of you might be, you will be going to your mobile phone, check for updates, check for calendar. So now it has been embedded. Everything has been embedded. This is a embedded, or the technology has become the part of human being. Rather, you can say it has become an extension of a human being. The digital assistant, the personal assistants, they are there to guide you through everywhere. Whether it is a new place, you are not knowing your destination, whether you want to start your research, everywhere you'll find that the information technology has impacted, and it has impacted to the extent that for the very, very young, very small kids, we may have to have some kind of institutions where we can put them, and we can make them away from the mobile phone or devices like that. So similarly, Government of India has now taken some initiative in banning some of the games, because the students were getting addicted and all those things. So the plus point with IT is that whether it is business, whether it is engineering, if I talk Industry 4.0, I don't see anything happening with the industry, or as has been told by Madam Garg, that chemical engineering, but it is all computer science and IT. So if there is a chemical process, if I can put sensors, if I can put there the cameras, if I can monitor each and every event of that, maybe I may be in a position to enhance the productivity by 100%. So it may be that the output goes 200%. And this is the power of IT. In business, yes. Everyone of you know what is happening in the business. A lot of data analytics has come in and everything has been analyzed. If any one of you go to Google and search for a ticket to USA, maybe your email IDs, everything will be filled with so many offers to travel to USA. How is it going to happen? What is the mechanism behind? It is all IT. So information technology is playing a big role. Even your houses, your automated smart houses can be remotely controlled by you. Your vehicles can be controlled by you. You can find out every bit of our daily life where we are embedded. We are related to devices or software related to information technology. So this has become a part, and more so now the advancement in artificial intelligence and machine learning, that is taking it one step ahead. So if Professor Arya is doing some chemical engineering work, and if we can simulate his work, how his mind is working, probably we can create a clone, IT related clone of Rajkumar Arya, who will be performing exactly how he might be performing. You might have listened and seen to the people that we are looking in that the news readers, there is no news reader, but allusion is created to the public that there is a person who is talking to you. Many more things. I think we have learned our expert, Mr. Parveen Verma. I congratulate Dr. Rajkumar Arya. He has been taking such initiative. I thank Madam Garg also, and I thank Mr. Parveen Verma, who has taken time from his busy schedule and will be enlightening all the experts, all those who have joined during this pandemic time. I hope that everyone connected and their near and dear ones, they are safe of COVID, and humanity as a whole come out of this COVID-19 at a sooner date. And instead of having webinar, we invite all the participants and the speakers on campus. Greetings from NIT Jalandhar. We are there on Twitter, we are there on Facebook, and if you find anything of value, kindly give your feedback to NIT Jalandhar on these social medias. And once again, happy Teachers Day. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you, sir, for the sharing your valuable inputs. So before we begin, let me first introduce you all to the experts of today's webinar. We have amidst us Mr. Parveen Verma, who is enriched with over 18 years of dynamic business experience in captive and service environment, with proven track record of product development, IP transformation, strengthening operational effectiveness. Mr. Verma is currently associated as the Global Director of Birlasoft Limited India, where he is responsible for global delivery for energy and utilities vertical operations. Earlier, he was associated with Exchanging as Head of Engineering Services from 2012 to 2019, and was based in several countries like UK, India, Malaysia, Australia, and Italy. He also worked with Infosys Limited India in various capacities as a solution architect, project management, and was also into IT consulting. On the educational front, Mr. Verma has a brilliant track record, having completed his BTech in chemical engineering from HBTI Kanpur, postgraduate diploma in business management, in marketing and finance with MDI Gurgaon. He also successfully completed a corporate leadership program for Indian School of Business, Hyderabad. So here is Praveen Verma. Over to you, Mr. Verma.
Thank you, Dr. Arya. It has been my pleasure to be part of this initiative, and that too on a very auspicious day of Teachers Day. I congratulate all the teachers, and I wish them all the gratitude from my side that whatever I've been today is because of the teachers that I've been like taught through my life. And I also try to pay my homage to my father. He was also a teacher, and that has a larger impact on my life all over the years that I have been through my education, my professional career and everything. So I give my humble respect and all those congratulations to all the teachers and respected Dr. Lalit. He has very brilliantly and very aptly articulated the role of IT and computer engineering, computer science, in not only industry and individuals' lives also. We have been largely impacted with IT in our personal lives. And if we are having this webinar today, it's also because of that. In this pandemic time, we are connected through a virtual media, which is webinar, and that is also one of the dimension of the IT. So that is how we'll start with today's session. And once again, I would like to thank everybody out here for spending their finding out time for this session. And we'll just briefly touch upon how IT is actually touching upon various different dimensions in industry, and on particularly energy and utility industry. I've taken an example of that for today's session, and we will talk about that. So I'll be sharing my presentation. So let me know once you see the screen. So firstly, once again, I would like to thank everybody and the esteemed faculty of NIT Jalandhar, Dr. Lalit Kumar Awasthi, HOD, Director, NIT Jalandhar, Dr. Sangeeta Garg, HOD, Chemical Engineering Department, Dr. Rajkumar Arya, Dr. AK Awasthi, AK Tiwari. Thanks for giving me time and opportunity to talk on this platform and talk about the topic that we have for today, that IT is not just an enabler, but an essential element of engineering and business operations. So I just want to ask, I'll try to make it a little more interactive, because I normally have those interactive sessions whenever I come across on those platforms. I try to make those sessions a little interactive so that we can keep the audience engaged. So I just want to understand, what do you think, like, what is the role of an engineer is? Anybody if wants to talk about? Any volunteer?
Yeah, actually I can say something, that engineer means which can find the easiest solution of a particular problem. That's actually, I think, as the role of engineer.
Absolutely right, Dr. Arya. I think that's bang on.
Good morning. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, actually, an engineer, in my point of view, is a person who kind of uses the basic theories of science and mathematics to kind of make useful products or useful things that we deal with in our daily lives, and how to optimize the process. As I'm a process engineer, so I'll be focusing more on, in terms of chemical or process engineering, how to optimize that process so that we can effectively kind of reduce the cost for making that product, and we can kind of maximize the profit. So that is the role of engineer in a kind of way, I may say. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I think both of you were like quite right on that, and it's the role of an engineer is basically a problem solver who basically solves the problems, be it a engineering problem or designing new thing or designing a solution or devising a solution which is a cost effective solution and which could generate economic value as well. Because only finding a solution is not important. Finding a solution which can be commercialized, which can be converted into economic value, is also one of the dimension which is an important dimension when it comes to engineering and industry. So any engineering solution, if it is economically viable and can be commercialized, it makes a new dimension to the industry. It creates a new product life cycle or a product line in altogether. So that is the role of an engineer. It could be maybe designing new things, maybe in my current operations, if I need to maintain certain things and some troubles or some problems are coming, I may have to go and solve those problems. So he has to be responsive. He has to be thinking about the designs. He has to look at what technology can bring into it to solve a particular problem. So all these dimensions are there, but the basic role, if you see, would be a problem solver, which Dr. Arya has very precisely mentioned at the very first thing about the role of an engineer. So now coming to the industry which we are talking today about is energy and utility. If we look at energy and utility industry, it is primarily divided into four different pillars. First is oil field services, kind of equipment making and manufacturing those equipments which are required for energy and utility industry in terms of exploring new locations for renewable source of energy or putting up new installations at different places for getting renewable and non-renewable source of energy. It could be solar, winds and also as well. But predominantly energy utility industry revolves around non-renewable source of energy, that is petroleum and all. So the first field is about oil and field services. Second stream is about upstreams, where the industry is looking for exploring the new oil fields, digging out new oil wells, rigs and all that to extract the oil out of the earth and oceans and all that. So there are organizations who are specialized in that particular area of work. Then there is a midstream which basically works on transporting of all these recovered oil from the earth and oceans on various different places to get this refined and then converted into various different products through distillation process and all that. So that midstream industry is there. And then there is a downstream, which are primarily refineries, petrochemical refineries, like we are like predominantly doing all our Indian PSUs and Reliance and all those organizations are predominantly in that space. But if you look at the overall spectrum, there have been worldwide organizations like NOV, Weatherford are primarily in the oil field services company. The upstream companies like ONGC Videsh and Nobel Energy, Shell, all these companies are specifically in the upstream business. Then in the midstream business, we have for like Crestwood and Genus Energies and all those companies. Gale also comes into that because that is also in more of a terminals and transportation of gas typically. It also falls into refining part. It has its own refineries at various different places in India. So this is how the oil and gas industry is kind of spread across, and all these comes under the umbrella of energies and utility and when we talk about the industry. So this was just a brief of what industry we operate into and how this we'll be seeing like how IT is actually helping this industry to not only generate and manage the business, but also reinvent few things and discover new elements of IT, which can make this particular industry a more profitable industry. And as you know that these days oil prices are down rocket bottom. And at this point in time, running these industry at itself is a challenge. So unless until industry looks at it differently, try to look at technology as one of the important element to boost the things which can bring efficiency into the system, which can cut the cost of maintenance and all that, this industry is struggling at this point in time. And IT is one thing which is looked at as a catalyst to rekindle the momentum and kind of rejuvenate this particular industry. So this is how we look at this industry at this point in time. This is just a high level view, like how IT and ITS is actually impacting the the industry as such. So if you look at, we have four different dimensions in ENU industry. One is the design element. You basically work on various different designs to explore oils from the various different oil fields, or design certain processes to optimize the refining process, or you do various kind of installations. So there is a lot of design element to this industry. Then there is manufacturing and maintenance, because you install those installations on different places. It requires a lot of maintenance, because it works with very rough surfaces where lot of rusting element is to this. There are lot of mud which is kind of impacting those equipments, which are very costly. So there is a very high element of maintenance also in this particular industry. Then in production line, if you see, there have been like operations which requires to be optimized to run these operations economically and make them viable with respect to the economic value of this. And then there is exploration, which is about discovering new oil fields and rigs and all that. So these are the four dimensions. We'll just look at how and what activities we typically do on those areas. So when we talk about designs, it's about we create a lot of designing. We are trying. We do a lot of drawing. We do a lot of material selections for designing those equipments, be it a heat exchanger, be it a distillation tower, or be it any of the engineering equipment that we might need to design. So there is a lot of drawing element, there is a lot of material selection element, there is a lot of simulation exercise we need to do. Similarly, if you look at manufacturing and maintenance, what actually we do, we basically do a lot of batch planning, we do rotation of the assets, we do a lot of diagnostics to measure the performance of certain equipments. So there have been like various sensors which generate a lot of data, which is used to get some tangible information out of that, which can be used to provide a maintenance strategy for a particular equipment. So these kind of things we do. We do a lot of ticketing also. Whenever a particular asset goes for a servicing, it goes through a support system where it has been tracked through what particular operations have been done on this particular equipment to perform the optimal performance of that equipment. So it might go through washing, it might go to servicing of that equipment, it might go through the repair of that particular system based upon the kind of maintenance it requires. So it might follow a different workflow for that. So they are a system which help you to track the assets within the organization, like where exactly these assets are lying and how these assets can be brought into life back for operations. Similarly, for operations, we see there is a lot of planning which needs to be done in terms of production activities to be done. There have been like a lot of approvals you might need to secure for getting those productions being planned based upon the market scenarios. You might go for a higher production, or you might go for a low performance, or putting your operations at a lower level. So those kind of systems are there, which helps you to flow this information within the teams to operate. They have been planning side of it, like if there is a demand, then you might need to simulate the production. If there is a demand is going on, you might need to cut down on your productions. So all those kind of analysis and information flow also happens through IT systems. And then there is a sales and distribution. So you do a lot of marketing, sales activities, and all those things are being also managed through various different IT operations. You create certain customers which needs, you create those prospects into the systems, then they flow through various life cycles, get converted into customers, and then you fulfill the demand from those customers. And at the same time, it's all about connecting with your employees. So you always have one dimensions to your employees, which help you to connect to your employers. So there is a set of IT systems which helps you to connect with your employees, your typical HR function which operates on those employee engagement platforms, and keep your employees motivated, engaged, and for their any needs they can connect to the organizations through those systems. So that is about productions and operations. Now about exploration and optimization, there have been like various different activities that might need be required. It could be remote sensing, it could be photometry that you might need to perform on various different remote locations to explore if a particular type of pattern is being matched, so that you can explore that further without even going to that place. You could do it remotely first in a cost-effective manner. And once that initial validation is validated, you can explore that thoroughly, and you could save on a lot of time and cost. So these kind of photometric techniques and remote sensing exercise, which needs to be carried out before going to those remote places for exploration. So that is also kind of been enabled and supported by IT a lot to cut down cost of operations and cut down cost of exploration. So and invariably there is a lot of data which is being generated, and there have been sayings like data is the new gold, and mining data is something which is very, very important, not only for individuals but for also industry to cut down the cost of operations, to bring efficiency into their operations, and take the industry to a industry 4.0, which Madam Sangeeta Garg was also referring to. So this is how data is one of the important element which is going to help and transform the industry altogether. So we'll touch upon that also in the subsequent slide. So in case of any questions, please feel free to ask. I'll be more than happy, because otherwise it feels like a monologue, which doesn't give much comfort to me. So I'll be very happy if you have any questions. Please feel free to ask in between.
See, actually I am happy, Praveen, that you are actually correlating everything to our chemical engineering, because I thought that you will talk completely IT. So it's very actually interesting presentation. Actually, you have covered entire chemical industry and correlating everything to that, to IT actually. So it's good, actually excellent presentation.
Thanks, Dr. Arya. But in case any questions, if you are having some questions coming on your chat board also, please let me know, because I could not see that.
Sure. I will let you know.
So I'll now relate these with the kind of softwares available for designing and all that. If you see, there are softwares like MATLAB. I believe MATLAB you must be using at your institute also for simulations and doing various kind of modeling. So similarly, there are other softwares like Aspen and AutoTech for chemical processing are available. And there is a dimension of a CAMCAD also. Typically, we have heard of AutoCAD and all that, which is typically used in the automobile industry and in the manufacturing. But there is one flavor of that is available in for chemical engineering also, that is CAMCAD, which is also being used for process designing and a lot of modeling activities for chemical processes. Similarly, there is another company called Anusys, which also has certain process simulation softwares. So these are the typical softwares which are being used in the industry for designing activities. Similarly, for maintenance and manufacturing, if you see, there have been very standard products from companies like Oracle and Microsoft and SAP are there. There have been like few solutions which are open source technology solutions, which are not standard kind of products available out of the shelf, but they are like custom solutions built out of open technologies for maintaining the manufacturing and the maintenance processes of any of the industries. So this is just to give you a flavor like how IT is related to all these functions. And there are standard companies and standard out-of-the-shelf products available in the market, which are being used by these organizations for their operations. And if I look
Go ahead. Praveen, actually, one participant is asking a question: how can we make this IT and ITES effectively, economically, and with reliability in Indian context?
Okay, in Indian context. Yeah. So if you look at ITs anyways
in smart city applications, actually he was talking about.
Okay, so smart cities, shall we park this question for a later time, because I'll be talking on those dimensions. I will keep a note of that, but we will discuss about it.
Fine.
Okay, so now coming to the production operations, if you look at, so there are standard ERP systems available from the big players like Oracle and SAP and Microsoft, which are used for various different functions like finance and their manufacturing planning, their supply chain planning, their demand and supply planning. So these are having a standard product which have kind of generic process flows and definitions being defined as industry standards, which are used by various different industries and organizations. They do a lot, some amount of customizations also on top of those standard configurations, but that is a limited, and if you do a lot of customization, then you lose the essence of the product. So you basically make a choose, make a decision whether you want to use a standard out of the shelf product or you want to build your own. So organizations have been doing both, if you look at the industry. So there have been organizations who rely on the standard products from these big players because they get a lot of benefit out of it. They get an annual maintenance, they get a lot of discounting if they rely on a one particular shop for various different functions. So that kind of economical viability they validate. In parallel to that, there's a section of industry which relies on open technologies and build their applications for their own processes because they want to keep their processes very unique from others, and they have their own kind of thought process in terms of defining those processes. So this space is again very widespread and is being very competitively being kind of operated within these three pillars, or I would say products and open source technology products. And then there is a fourth dimension about exploration things. So we have like standard open source technologies which are used for modeling and data modeling and for analyzing the data. Typically they use statistical model to build upon on those platforms, like for that typically they use Pythons and R and other data analytics solutions which help them to model that statistical model to analyze large volume of data and do a analysis on that data to find the proper match for a particular data set given, if it is rightly matching to the oil fields that they have already discovered in past and all that. So based upon that, this data modeling exercise is being carried out, and they go for those identified areas for further kind of exploration. So this is how IT helps them to explore and analyze the data set. I'll move to the next one, which is about how automation progresses in the industry in various different stages. That is the reflection of Industry 4.0, which Madam Sangeeta Garg was also referring earlier, and Dr. Lalit has also talked about it, like how we see industry is going towards 4.0 as future state. So it has started from very basic element of intervention of IT and automation when we got introduced to your distributed control systems and programmable logic controllers as a first order kind of automation, and IT levers started penetrating or started helping industry to take benefit of that. So from there we have started, the industry has grown to a stage where things are now being remotely controlled with the help of your mobile devices and all that. So this is the progression of the industry from first order to second order to third order. As I mentioned, the first order was primarily emphasizing on only distributed controls and having some element of sensors deployed on those equipments to get the kind of inputs which are required for decision making. But the decision making was predominantly being done by humans only. So that was the stage when we were just using certain panels for giving me readings of, let's say, temperatures or pressure and all that. But the actual decision to control that for a specific process was being taken by humans. You must have seen in the industry, and probably most of you must have visited chemical plants also. If you have seen, they have been like plants stalled outside about a kilometer out, and their control systems are about somewhere in the about a kilometer or half kilometer from that plant, because these for the safety of the individuals also the industry designs it like that, because in past there have been incidents when these plants have some accidents and that has caused a lot of loss to the life and all. So that was probably way back in 1950s or somewhere, but gradually industry has moved from those places to having those control elements being given at a remote place, or not remote but exactly at least a kilometer or a half a kilometer away from those actual plants, to basically have those inputs on their screens, and then they can decide whether they need to increase the pressure or decrease the pressure or release the pressure for optimally running that operations and generating that output from those plants. So that was kind of first or second level of kind of intervention that these elements have put on industry. When we have seen those distributed control systems are available, primarily organizations like Hitachi and all those companies have been producing those distributed control systems. They are attached to those equipments for reading those and sensing out those information. Then there have been a third generation of thing has come, where this particular input is again going one stage ahead and gone into a kind of World Wide Web. Now you don't need to be available on those vicinities to control those equipments. Even from a remote location or around the world globe, you could control those equipments by having those controls being made available to World Wide Web. So you could imagine to control your rig operation in deep in sea from a well connected city office also. So this is how the industry is actually expanding and giving a lot of benefit in terms of ensuring safety of employees, ensuring no difficult posting of those people at those places. Of course, you would need certain amount of people for like close monitoring, but majority of the operations can be carried out from a remote place also. So this is being enabled by IT, because all those things can flow through internet, and then a remote location can be used for controlling those setups at different places. And the final situation that we look at as Industry 4.0 is connected industries, where industry would be talking to each other. Industry is reaching to a stage where automated algorithms or artificial intelligence can control those operations by itself. It would not need a human intervention to control those operations. So that is what would be Industry 4.0, when industries would be talking to each other on their own, when these controls will be taken care by those bots to run the operations and take decisions also, not only run the operation but could take decisions also based upon various different artificial intelligence algorithms. And again, if we talk about artificial intelligence algorithms, it falls into three different categories. One kind of artificial intelligence algorithms are typically supervised algorithms. The other is unsupervised algorithm, and the third is reinforced algorithms. When we talk about supervised algorithm, which means your bot or your artificial intelligence engine is running on some amount of training given to that particular bot with past historic data. Based upon your historic data, the engine has been trained to take certain decisions. That is what we call it as a supervised machine learning algorithms. Then you have unsupervised machine learning algorithms, which means that there is no training element, but the bot is the algorithm is built like that. It basically discovers, understand it, and then identify a pattern in that and then take decisions. That is unsupervised bot. And then there is third element of it is reinforced bots, which are like they do a trial and error kind of approach, try to simulate human behavior in taking decisions, and based upon their trial and error outcome, they learn or unlearn things. So a bot can make a mistake, But next time a similar situation would come, the bot will not take that mistake, would do that mistake. It will learn from its own mistake, and with the trial and error of activities, the bot would learn, enrich its learning, and come to a stage where it start executing more efficiently and reaching to a stage where the bot could simulate a behavior of a human. So that, this is how these different algorithms are being looked at, and helps are being worked upon also, like industry is anyways working on those different areas to make this enable. You must have heard about automated cars and self-driven cars and all those things. So all these things are actually based upon on these principles. So whenever you come across those kind of buzzwords which are being thrown upon to us as a common man, we need to understand, like, what are the engineering principles, or what are the principles behind those kind of communication or kind of that information that is coming to us. So this is how the industry is moving, and it is very, very important to understand, with the growing emphasis on the technology and having the penetration of IT industry across the globe, not only in India. If you see, India has also enormously grown in terms of having internet penetrations to the remotest places in India, and which has enabled us to come and fight this COVID very well, because a lot of things could be done remotely and there was no need to manually do that activity, and that has helped a lot in terms of we as a nation to overcome or kind of fight this challenge. So similarly, this industry is also looking at how these technology penetrations can be leveraged to take the industry to a next level, where all these operations which are repeated in nature can be automated. And if there is some amount of learning or human intelligence needs to be replicated through artificial intelligence, can also be done through the concept of machine learning and artificial intelligence. And any questions if you have? Hello? Am I audible?
Excuse me. Yeah, you are. Sir,
can I audible? Yeah.
Sir, what is the difference between 4G and 5G?
So that's a different area of expertise. Unfortunately, I would not be able to answer that. That falls under the purview of IT and telecommunications. Maybe Mr. Arya has to invite another expert for that. But to be very at a high level, if I need to talk, there is basically what IT does is transmit data from in terms of packets from one place to another place through different media. In 4G and 5G, the protocol are being challenged, and different protocols are being used for transmitting the data, which are much faster than what we have in 4G. So if you could transmit data at a speed of, let's say, X in 4G, you could be able to do it much faster in 5G, because your underlying protocol of transmitting that data is totally different. That is at a very, very high level, I would say around 50,000 feet high level of response. But if you look for a precise answer, I think IT telecommunication expert would be a better person to answer that.
Sir, one more question. In this pandemic situation, which is suitable for, because everything is going online, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah. Which technology is best for everyone or all the field? Can you suggest if you have any idea about that?
Sorry, I didn't get your question. Which technology?
Yeah, any technology in the sense that means everything is online, right? So yeah. 4G, I attended so many related this type of artificial intelligence, IoT, lot of programs I attended. Okay, 3G, 4G, demystifying, and then all the program I attended. So what is my doubt is, in this pandemic days, which technology is very easy to, even rural area also people are suffering to not getting network, correct? So which is suitable for them in the pandemic situation. Can you tell me?
So I think your question is about enabling connectivity, the reliable connectivity to the remotest places in countries like India, right?
Yes, of course. Yes.
So to answer that, the best connectivity in the current scenario, you could get it through your fiber optic lines. If you do not have those fiber optic lines, then there are technologies like Facebook balloon technology is coming up, which is talking about transmitting those Wi-Fi transmissions through balloons, which would be floating around the world. That is another, but those are the concept which probably would take time to get realized and get actually.
Not satellites.
It will be floating balloons across the globe, which could transmit those Wi-Fi signals.
Okay.
So, but I would say in the current scenario, the technology that we have been using in India is kind of serving the purpose, because we could see the connectivity available in the remotest parts of India through those fiber optical lines available till the hubs, and then the transmission is happening over the Wi-Fi.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I have a question, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Please.
Sir, this question actually extends to for chemical engineers. Actually, for chemical engineering students, this IT and computer science is very underrated subject.
Mm-hmm.
If at BTech level or UG level programs, and when they actually enter the industry after their BTech, they are encountered with different controllers or different kind of computational things.
Right.
So what should be the kind of step forward to kind of minimize that gap, so that they do not take it as an underrated subject at their UG level, so that, because nowadays everything is pretty computational, so they have to have the knowledge of that computers and IT, and you talked about ANSYS, Python, and different programming languages. So what should be the approach, or the easiest approach, that they can actually be acquainted with those things at very ease? I mean, that was my question, sir.
So my response to that is, like, one should always look at least one programming language to be learned during the education phase, primarily in undergraduate at least. Now people are talking about having exposed to these programming language even at schools level, and schools have started doing that actually. In fact, if you look at, but I must recommend, and I would say, one should at least know one programming language, at least to have these concepts embedded within himself or herself to take on the next level of learning. Because those programming languages will keep on changing, and you might get new things coming on. But if you have built those concepts at a very basic level, you could always correlate and learn. So learning will always be a continuous process, and you have to go through that during your whole life, I would say. And one life is also not enough to learn an entire thing. But at least building concepts on one programming language should be one's preference at undergraduate level.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you for the fulfilling presentation, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay, so moving to the next, I'll just briefly talk about top technology trends which are currently prevailing in the industry. So one is artificial intelligence, another one is machine learning, these two are kind of correlated. And then you have robotic process automations. So there is a lot of emphasis, and it's currently being widely used at various different places in the industry. Like, whatever a human can do, some smaller operations can be automated, and a robot can also do that. So that is remote process automation. Then there is a new element of edge computing, which is not a new concept as such, but this talks about doing things remotely, distributedly, map reduce way. So that we'll talk briefly on that. And then there is a concept of augmented reality. Augmented reality is a very interesting concept, because it helps you to simulate environment around you, and can be used to train people on for different scenarios and remote places. So these are the top technology trends which are currently prevailing. And if you look at artificial intelligence, it basically gives a cognitive capability to mimic human intelligence by itself, which can be used for predictive maintenance and improving energy efficiency for a particular machine. Then there are machine learning, which basically enables you to do something which is not programmed earlier. As we briefly talked about this in the previous slide also, like supervised machine learning algorithms, unsupervised and reinforced. So which is something, this particular thing has not been built as a programming, but your program is built in such a way that algorithm is capable to learn on its own by various different techniques. So this is also used for fault detections. Then there is a, as I told you, like business process automations. So certain activities, let's say I need to book a ticket. I need to go to a website and log in there and do a ticket for myself. I can do it myself, and a bot can also do it for me. So there is a bot process or a robotic process which can go and log into that particular website, use my credentials, use my credit card and all that, and can book my ticket. So I might not need to do it myself, a bot can do. So the same concept is being used by industry for doing certain very mundane activities which requires no specific knowledge or human intelligence needs to be applied. But the process is designed in such a way that you need to take an input from X place, go to a Y place and execute, and then a Z outcome would come. So the process is in such a way can be automated and human intervention can be eliminated. So there are various reasons for doing so. One is your cost is one. The other thing is like reliability of human executing the same thing every time, same way is questionable. But if you train a bot, it will always do the same repeatedly without even asking a question and without even asking for a pay hike also. So there are multiple reasons these things are being picked up by the industry. Then there is a concept of edge computing, which I just briefly talked. Wherever there are connectivity challenges and you need to do those things remotely, you could give the capability of taking that decision to that remote component itself so that it can do the small amount of decision can be taken at that place. I related it from a human analogy perspective, like every response or every reaction you give to a particular event happened to you is not always triggered from your brain. It could be your spine could also send some signals, or your skin is also so sensitive that it doesn't even go back to your brain or spine to get a response what needs to be done. It can be done there itself. So this is how I relate these computing principles with human autonomy, and also to very nature, that how we as engineers are picking up certain patterns from various different things that we observe across happening up around us and use them in terms of building those engineering components. So that is edge computing. And then, as I talked about augmented reality, it creates an enhanced environment around you, which can help you to simulate trainings, which can give you remote field service assistance. Like we do a lot of remote assistance from our IT department. If my computer is not working, I might do some kind of customer care intervention with somebody to get things corrected. Similar way on a remote field service environment, let's say my fieldman is working at a different location and he needs an expert advice. You cannot always afford to have experts being traveling to that place. So you might create a concept or build certain components which could provide you remote assistance there itself. It could be through augmented glasses. We call it, there's a concept of Google glasses you might have heard of. So which gives you a kind of three-dimension input from a remote location, which can help you to solve that problem. I might not be knowing the design of a particular problem, but if I have a technician, I might need to go and work on a particular problem to solve. I might need to juggle around various technical specifications. But if an expert who can help me remotely, that concept can be used, and it is being used also now in industry for those remote assistants in terms of fixing the problems at remote places or in plants. They basically leverage the highly skilled expert at their base location to facilitate the support to maybe 10 or 20 different field service executives. So this is how they try to make a hub and spoke model to enable all their field service agents with that kind of input coming from a central place. So those are the kind of use cases that you would see in industry happening around, which are kind of realized through the intervention of IT. Just a quick reflection. So what we have just gone through, I just want to make a quick reflection of it. In specifically in the energy and utility industry, I will just be throwing a picture before you, and I would be happy if someone can point what kind of intervention or a technology trend would be applicable at what places. So this is a typical upstream activities that a energy and utility organization would be doing. They will be doing a pre-drilling assessment. They might be doing drilling operations, and then they will be doing a post-drilling operations. So this is a pictorial view of that. Can we identify which technology trend could be impacting these phases? Any guesses? Any says? Okay, so I'll take a shot on this. So if you look at down bottom at the pole, you could see a application of edge computing and artificial intelligence to guide your driller or the equipment which is being used for drilling to take certain amount of decisions, or maybe backtracing from there in case of it is hitting some element which is not meant for this particular device to penetrate through. So those kind of use cases can be explored. These equipments can be enabled with those sensors and computing capabilities to take those decisions locally, and can prevent those equipments from break, and could save a lot of money for those organizations too, in terms of if they need to replace that equipment or do a lot of maintenance. So that is the use case that is gonna help this industry to cut on their operational cost or the maintenance cost in this case. Similarly, if you see the augmented reality and analytics could be helpful in the environment assessment, where they could simulate the environments, they could do a modeling of it, and then do a lot of analysis on top of it to pinpoint the locations where they might need to actually go and do the excavation or do the drilling. So that kind of activity can be helped through those augmented reality and analytics applications. Similarly, augmented reality and machine learning would be applicable in those typical drilling operations also, to remote assisting the field service agents and enabling your equipments with a certain amount of decision taking capabilities. And the last one. Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Sir, this one is, they are keeping hoardings now. Abroad and all, they are keeping hoardings. That hoardings also, which technology they are using?
So there have been like lots of kind of programming languages available, which are being used. But the concept is, you need to understand the concept. What is the concept behind those languages? The language is just a translation of that algorithm into a programming language. The concept is whether I'm going to use maybe like I want to take certain decision based upon my linear regression analysis, or by maybe I want to apply a fuzzy logic. So if I have identified a logic to be, I have defined a solution and defined the algorithm in terms of what would be my logic to solve this problem or give this capability to this equipment, the programming language is the secondary thing. First thing is about what are the basic building blocks or elements of core mathematics or logical decision making I want to use to build that or give that capability to that particular component. The programming language is just to translate that logic into which can be executed on top of that component. So programming comes second. First thing is having that understanding of the solution and the underlying logic or the algorithm which I want to apply on that. Because as I said, like those programming language have been continuously being evolving, and we have been seeing like we started from very basic level of programming from, let's say, GW basics to now we have various different languages available which are there to translate those algorithms into executable programs.
So Praveen, would you mind repeating the question?
Hello?
I just wanted to understand the audience question one more time.
Okay. So I think the question was like, what are the programming languages used for defining those like components and algorithms? So that was the question originally. I think I would be happy if you can also add your
The choice of programming language is secondary. I think the problem domain that you are into, solid understanding of that, what data is relevant for you, what you need to acquire that data and converting it into meaningful insight or action, designing all those aspects is probably more important than the underlying medium of programming language, right?
Absolutely, absolutely right.
And depending upon industry type, when it comes to data acquisition and control systems, there are a lot of proprietary technologies which play, right? But right. Once you have essentially acquired the data, what you do with it, that's where the role of IT comes in. So there's a lot of proprietary technologies in play on the operations technology side of it. IT is where everything works at a great leveler. I think as chemical engineers, let's understand.
Rakesh, the problem. I would love to see your face actually. Can you turn on the video?
No, I think let's keep it this way only.
Okay.
So, as I was saying, right, I think as chemical engineers, understanding a problem domain is of paramount importance. So the enterprise IT technologies are continuously evolving, but the investments that large organizations have already made with respect to their business operations, right, out there, the cycle doesn't change too frequent, right? The life of a SCADA system is going to be far few more decades compared to a ERP system. So I'm not sure, Praveen, if I help you answer that question or
no. I think Rakesh, you did a very justified response to that, and I think you have very well put that. I believe the question has been answered. If any further discussion is needed, please feel free to ask further questions.
So Praveen, Ashish, a quick question. Do you see in the long term artificial intelligence moving to edge devices rather than being centrally being used, given the situation that they do have capability to learn on their own and being completely autonomous and outside the human control purview? So do you see this trend kind of evolving where two different technologies kind of getting married to each other?
Certainly, Ashish, that would be the future of this. I have no doubt in saying so.
So Ashish, ultimately Praveen is a speaker, but yeah, academically, yes, I don't want it to happen during my lifetime.
But that's the reality, Rakesh. You would be seeing that in lifetime, I would say.
Yeah, thanks, Praveen.
Thanks, Ashish. So shall we move ahead, or you have any further questions, audience? Mr. Arya, Dr. Arya?
Yeah. Can you continue? It's
okay.
Good. It's going well, actually.
Okay. So this is just a recap of like how machine learning and artificial intelligence is actually helping, or maybe kind of giving an impact on oil and gas industry. So if you all know, like we all know that oil and gas industry is the industry which has been using these digital technologies for years, and because it has to, there's no shortcut to do that. They always have to rely on those sensors inputs which they could kind of interpret it and take those decisions. So this is how this industry is evolving and continuously being leveraging that. But with the growing kind of exploration on the machine learning and artificial intelligence, this is definitely gonna help this industry to bring more efficiency to their operations and make it more economically viable with respect to maintaining those assets that they have, those expensive assets. They need definitely some kind of input to do this maintenance much more proactively rather than reactively. And for that, they have to rely on those machine learning algorithms to do some kind of deep learning or IoT-based interventions, which could help them detect those faults in those equipments from pattern matching and those kind of analysis. So that is one aspect. The other aspect is when I say about exploration activities, there will be a lot of cost saving in terms of exploring those remote places with a prior information on the pattern of that area, the seismic understanding of that area, the simulations must have been done prior to actually doing those initial drilling activities to validate whether the well model that has been built on top of that data analyzed is actually correct or not. So this would definitely help these in this particular industry in terms of saving a lot of kind of money in terms of doing those exploration activities and also on the maintenance side. So this is one reflection of previous slides. I just wanted to recap, kind of recap on this. And if you see, there is an estimation from McKinsey for this industry to save around $50 billion by leveraging these machine learning and big data analytics kind of IT components. So that is all I have for this session today. I'll leave the floor open for the questions, and we'll be happy to respond, and in case something get unanswered, so I'll be happy to respond offline.
Yeah, actually participant can ask the questions, and
Praveen, this is Murli here. I have a question.
Yeah, hi Murli.
Yeah, so from the Indian context, you know, how much do you think our oil and gas industry is leveraging the technology? I know, like, you know, in US and other countries, there are a lot of penetration, but with all this digitization and many places coming in, so how much they are tech savvy in terms of Indian oil and gas industries?
So Murli, unfortunately, I have not been very first-hand information from the Indian kind of organizations on this topic. But of course, they have been using the IT systems for their operations. That is invariably there. But how much kind of technology they have been using in terms of doing those exploration and all those things, probably we need to check with the experts from ONGC, and Mr. Raj has earlier invited, I guess, Mr. Hemant Sonkar or somebody from the actual industry who is actually hands-on doing those activity would be much better position to answer that. But yes, of course, these industries have been using IT system for operationally, that is invariably there.
So Praveen, I can probably chime in from a enterprise IT technology perspective. So guys, this is my experience working with some of the downstream players in Indian context. They are ahead of the technology curve when it comes to enterprise IT technologies. Whether it is a Reliance, whether it is a HPCL or a BPCL, they're far ahead vis-a-vis their peers in North America and Europe. That's purely from enterprise IT technology perspective.
Right. So that is primarily on the operation side of it, right?
So yeah, Jamnagar refinery is probably one of the most complex hydrocarbon processing operations in the world, right?
Right, correct. It's one of the biggest.
So I can read.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Sir? Hello?
Yeah, we can hear.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Yes, Vijay, please go ahead.
Sir, is that chemical engineers and pharmacists are related in industries or they are different, sir?
Sorry?
His question is that chemical engineers and pharmacists are they related or they are different?
So, I can just briefly talk about like industries are converging and see if you look at every industry would have a role for every type of engineers. You could be having all those complementary skills coming together to come up with a new industry. And if you say pharmaceutical industry, it is a combination of, you can say, the medical practitioners and your chemical practitioners coming together to build that kind of environment where they could create those manufacture those medicines at a larger scale for economical purposes. So pharmacy is a combination of that. They are having a heavy investment on the R&D side for new drug discoveries. At the same time, they will have a manufacturing unit which will be doing a generic manufacturing of all those chemicals required to have those medicines being kind of manufactured. So any industry would be a combination of all. But I would say these two are the predominantly kind of skills you would need to have in this particular industry.
Thank you, sir.
So, Praveen sir, it's really a nice session and knowledgeable also. So, we are thankful for the chemical engineering. We are thankful to you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I would like to take 1 minute if Mr. Rajkumar Arya allow me.
Yeah, you can take more than that. You are most welcome. Actually, thank you very much for the joining it. I know you have a very busy schedule, so you can take your time. Yeah, you can.
Thank you, Mr. Arya, and thank you, Mr. Verma. Just wanted to add, Praveen, that being in the design industry from around 20 years, whatever means the IT industry, I can just add to your presentation. That like there were some questions that how we are using basically oil and gas section. So right. Let me tell you a brief thing that like in a refinery, the IT industry is so important right now because if you see our market is fluctuating and not even every day, it's every moment, right?
Correct.
Demand, if you see the demand of the market related to the how much I am just going to a crude words like how much diesel you required, how much petrol you required, how much gas you required,
right.
How much kerosene you required. So,
right.
So if I see on a chemical engineering point of view, we have a column, right?
Right.
Column, we take mid extract, we take bottom extract, we take top extract, and it depends on the required quality of that product in the market.
Right. Right.
What is actually happening nowadays that suppose today you need a more demand for the petrol, you don't need to basically analyze the parameter for 1 week and 2 week that how to do it. You have a single button that depending on the temperature analysis or pressure analysis, You right. just push it and the parameters changes accordingly to increase your diesel demand or to increase your petrol demand or to meet your kerosene demand. So right. these are the fractions, which fractions you require at that moment on a more more quantity, it can be automatically adjusted. So that right. is the best example I can give right now, the use of IT being in the chemical industry.
Right.
And there was one thing, the remote operation. Right now, you see, we are into that thing. We are sometimes facing these things that our client is sitting in US and UK. Our plant is in Iraq, and Iraq is a place where you cannot put a lot of your human resource inside the plant. You yeah. have to put the minimum required operations people into the plant, and rest other thing is every day, not every day, every movement is controlled by the US client or UK client. They can mm. change the production demand. They can meet the market requirement, the quality,
right.
okay, and they can keep an a watch on the operators that how the parameters are getting changed, how much is today, what is the quality of the product, and that is getting analyzed
right.
Every day, okay, right. and accordingly the next day target is getting set.
Right.
So I think it's the industry. Without that, I think right now it's very difficult to even imagine the running of these plants.
I think Himanshu, you have seen the industry for the last 20 years, and you must have noticed the transformation this industry has gone through over the years, right?
Exactly. Means when I started my career, the project schedule was going to happen, a mid-size project was around 4 years or 5 years. Now nobody can wait for 4 or 5 years. They demand the plant in 12 months, 18 right. months, right? And they demand the production accordingly.
They have the project, even these days, they have the project live around 4 to 5 years sometimes, right? Maybe.
Exactly. And nobody, yeah. now no client want to wait for their production to get their money back in 4 or 5 years.
Right.
Right. That's all from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Himanshu, for adding this valuable input to this discussion.
Parveen, we have one question from one of the participants.
Yes, sir.
Saraina Palival. So she asked, being a chemical engineer, which of these technologies could be most beautiful or most helpful for research career? She is interested in the research, and she wants to that which of these I can say the general opinion from my side, all of them are actually most important. You cannot leave them actually.
Yeah, I would say data analytics would be the most important. Data analytics would be the most important for any kind of research, because whatever data would you be generating as part of your experiments on those research assignments, or maybe looking at historic data, that would definitely require a lot of analysis, and data analytics and statistical modeling would be the key skills for this activity. That is what I have to say on this.
Yeah, and also just to add this, Murli, I think ERP is the main foundation of any industry, and you know, most of the, end of the day, the business and technology are like today married to each other. And next generation of engineers, I think it is very important, as Praveen said, to, you know, kind of have some level of technical knowledge. I know during our times, we did not have that privilege. But today in the world of open source coding and the, social media, I think the new generation is much more equipped to kind of handle those challenges of technology. And it is must to have in any kind of industry, whether it's chemical engineer, mechanical engineer, any stream. So I think it's pretty exciting session, and I'm sure there are a lot of industries who are also collaborating with some of the engineering colleges to train the next set of engineers in the technology area as well. So I think it's good to see these kind of sessions.
There are one more questions from Gala Venkatesh Swami. Do we require more farmers in IT or in agriculture sector for future?
Very interesting question. I think we would definitely need farmers, and that is the genesis of we getting energy. But how many farmers we would need is subject to the productivity that we generate out of that. So the answer to that is we have to maximize our output and increase our productivity. We just don't need to increase the number of farms.
Akhil Rastogi, do you want to ask something? Akhil, Ashish is there, Somit is there, Rajesh is there, Mohit is there. So
yeah, just to extend Praveen's thought, I think more IT in farming would be the way forward, right? There is no way out, right? When to start those pumps, pump the water. Yeah, Praveen.
Exactly. So Ashish, I think again, IT would be invariably an element of thing, or you can say a critical element now in every sphere of our lives. Without IT, I think there is no, we can't imagine things moving. This is such a large impact it is now bringing.
And just to give example, right, there are some startups in the agricultural sector today, IT startups, like AgroStar is one of my client. So what they do is they enable the sales platform, online sales platform for the farmers to get the best price. They can sell across the country. And it is no more like today farmers are they are also becoming the technology literate in terms of using the technology platform to sell their products.
Yeah, Murli, not only sell this product, but they also need to get inputs when to sow what and what kind of soil. So there's a lot of element of soil analysis, and there is a dimension to rotate the crop so that your soil doesn't get degraded with respect to its fertility. So the technology is playing role in all those dimensions. It is not only about providing those sales platform, it is also helping them to understand the nature of the soil that and help them what kind of crop they need to sow in.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I would say that it's everybody, what you're saying is right. IT boom, IT application in all the fields are it's inevitable. It's like industry revolution which we had in 1800. Now it's IT revolution. It has to, and it would be penetrating to all phases of our life, all aspects of our life.
Absolutely, Akhil.
Any other question from the participants? Anyone wants to say something, or shall we close this session here?
Yeah, Praveen, esoteric thought. Maybe you can extend your thoughts on that. Do you see any downside of IT?
Of course, there will be excess of anything would have a downside. That will basically have a downside, make us more lethargic. And we might need to spend our hours in gyms to get physically fit.
No, that is good as well, right? Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks,
actually,
for bringing
my
this.
Opinion, actually, a lot of innovations now, most of the time is speed, compatibility, and compactness of the system. So you always need a lot of mean the innovation in that field. So previously you were that much bigger, now you are going smaller, and at the same time compatibility and robustness and speed. So these are the things would always need more and more innovation. So in that context, I don't hope it may be a downfall somewhere. No, I don't hope so.
I think the next generation, it is more important for the next set of engineers to learn IT, because all the manual processes will be done by machines, and human beings will be actually used to develop those machines. So machine learning, artificial intelligence. So IT is no more a programming today. It's more of a smart artificial intelligence. So next set of engineers, I think it's not going to go anywhere, but actually we have to learn more of a robotics, more of a machine learning to train those robots and not do the manual work. Of course, there are a lot of other health hazards associated with this, but which will help pharma industry and medical industry. But I think next generation will be developing more robots than doing everything manual.
I think only we are heading towards that. That is something we could see written on the wall now.
Right.
Akhil, do you want to say something? Can I see your face at least?
Yeah, sure. Nothing to add on. I think it's...
how are you?
Doing good. Thank you. Thanks for inviting.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much for the joining the session, actually. So any questions from the participants before we close the session for today? Rajesh, want to say something?
No, Raj, just my mic was turned on, so it's okay. This was a very good interactive session today, so I really don't have much to say about it. So there was an esoteric thought, she said, can we see the downfall of IT in the future? But I was just wondering if everything is being relied upon on IT for everything, machine learning and these things are coming. Everything is dependent on robots, and everything will be done by robots and machines in the future. Then what will happen to the employment? I mean, there could be some unrest. Because everybody cannot be used for developing machine language, machine learning, or these things, or machines. So maybe there could be some social unrest in the future or distant future.
Probably, I think if some sooner or the later, if something we can put a check on population part, I hope that problem may not come.
Definitely solutions are there, but this kind of
solutions present, your point is 100% valid, because everything will be done by IT, then obviously there would be cut short in the employment actually.
So Rajesh, I will put it that way, if you want everybody to climb a tree, that's not something which can happen.
Definitely. Everybody is not equal. That's why I'm saying that.
You can't make everybody monkey.
I had a couple of friends when they were saying that artificial
intelligence.
So, okay, Praveen, I think we can close the session here. I think I hope there are no questions from the participants, and it was really amazing.
Good afternoon. I'm sorry, Mr. Rajkumar Arya, to be in between.
No problem. You can go ahead.
Sorry. My only one question is actually, Mr. Praveen sir, already Arya sir asked you from my side. Do we require more IT farmers or the agriculture farmers? You answered also before. Very good, sir. It's very good to hear the answer from you. Mm-hmm. My other thing is how long this technical things will continue, sir, in terms of IT or maybe computer science, whatever you say.
So my response to that is it all depends on human. We have been evolving from ages of stone age to this age, we have been continuously evolving, and I take it as a evolvement process of evolution only. And at this point in time, I don't see there is any stopping to this kind of evolution which is happening, and we are noticing with our own eyes now. If we see, we have seen the transformation from the ages where we could go to the banks and withdraw those money through those bank slips. Now, I guess no one of us actually go to the bank. Even we don't even withdraw money, right? So the transformation that we are seeing is, I would say, just inception of IT transformation, and it would be going at a much faster pace now. That is what I think it would be heading towards. But I don't say there will be any end to this in at least my lifespan.
Okay. Now the thing is, like, you know, a man's session of living on earth is between usually something 0 to till 80 or 100, as we all know that.
Mm-hmm.
But during this period, do we really require, and we think that we require always, you know, 100% of technical and technology things to come up. And, you know, we are losing our the stomach requirement, like in terms of food, which is very much essential to be there on the earth, first of all.
Right.
So in this process, if it is more than 200, 300 years, do we express, you know, it's the equivalent of the food item can present on the earth?
See, I would say I will take it like a exploitation side of it. And if we are continuously kind of using those resources at this particular pace, we would be definitely getting into challenges. As a human or as a society, we have to look at where we are heading towards and how we need to bring that balance. But that's a separate topic altogether, and that leads to a different discussion. But when we talk about technology and technology's interventions in the industry, that's a separate topic. So as a society, we have to look at how we can bring a balance to this kind of development and how we can bring synergy in technology interventions and consumption of those natural resources or per se. That is, I would say, a different topic altogether, and it requires a different discussion. So that's what my submission to this discussion.
Thank you, sir.
I answered it to your expectation.
Yeah, good sir. You know, the time limit, not only during the session, but also during the living on the earth, is also very small for us. So we have to agree with the such types of answers. So thank you, sir. Thank you, Arya, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, so I think we can close the session now. So I would like to thank our honorable directors, HOD madam, faculty members, and the participants. I would also like to thank our esteemed speaker for the afternoon, Mr. Praveen Verma, for sharing his valuable inputs about the topic. IT-related technologies has both tangible and intangible benefits that help in getting the desired customers' results by building the efficiency through effective data management, solving complex problems through comprehensive monitoring, and enhances online marketing strategies and promotional campaign and branding. Now, I would request all the participants to fill up the feedback form and send it to me at the earliest. I hope the webinar was a fruitful one, and we wish to conduct few more interesting sessions in coming weeks, and thank you. I would also like to thank our batchmate Mohit Pal, Rajesh Tomar, and Sumit Mohan, Aditya, Ashish, Paritosh, Himanshu Sachan, Akhil Rastogi for joining and managing some time from their busy schedule there. All of them are in the industry, having a reputed post and designation there, so many responsibilities. So joining this session much more interactive, actually. And at last, I will again thanks to Praveen Verma for making the session and presentation so much interacting and correlating to industry and IT everywhere in a very excellent manner. So thank you very much, Praveen, once more.
Thanks, Dr. Arya. It was my pleasure. And it was a pleasure to interact with students as well as the colleagues. And it is really a pleasure of mine. Absolute pleasure, I would say. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, everyone. We will close the meeting here. Thank you.